an interesting factor and intriguing setup for the Breeders' Cup Juvenile. Now we move to the fairer sex, the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies, and we take a look at some of the particulars again. They'll be going post-breed on Friday, same deal for the most part, $2 million on the line, mile and a 16th. And now we check out the division leaders, always a princess, two lifetime starts, a win, a maiden special weight victory, and then a second place finish in the Grade 1 Oakleaf Stakes here in Southern California.
And Blind Luck did beat her rather handily, and you have to obviously acknowledge Blind Luck's excellence because she began her career in a $40,000 maiden claimer at Calder, and Jerry Hollendorfer has done a fine job since they acquired her.
Princess, the leader, tackled by Bickerson's Pure Class down at the rails. Softly Singing is behind that. Blind Luck is in with a shot too. Homeward Bound in the Oak Leaf now, and here comes Blind Luck down the center of the track, and Blind Luck has just put them away with a 16th to go. And it's Blind Luck drawing clear. Blind Luck and Tyler Bays, very impressive in the Oak Leaf. Always a Princess second.
Frank, not often, and not even dumb luck or blind luck, but not often a horse begins his or her career in a $40,000 claimer anywhere and winds up as one of the major players at the end of the season in any Breeders' Cup race, particularly the Breeders' Cup juvenile races.
And that's what Blind Luck has done, and she deserves, you know, the stature that she has right now. But Always a Princess did something very, very good in her second start. First of all, after her debut race, in which she really didn't get going until the stretch, she just exploded through the lane in her debut, came back, and Baffert actually told Gomez to send her to the front and just to kind of get a big race into her leading up to the Breeders' Cup Juvenile Fillies. I think you're going to see a little bit of a different tactic in the big race here. And keep in mind, she is a sibling to Gabby's Golden Gal, who we've already seen her brilliance. So I would expect to see a top-notch performance from Always a Princess in the Breeders' Cup.
One more division we want to take a look at, and that is the Breeders' Cup Classic Division. And this will indeed, once again, be a very interesting lineup. Last year, European horses finishing 1-2. It could very well happen again, particularly with the likes of Rip Van Winkle and Master Craftsman. But first, we'll take a break. And as we do, Breeders' Cup tickets on sale now. First time ever, you can get them online. It's kind of like getting an airline ticket. Very simple, but more fun. We'll be back.
Believable. Curlin on the outside. Colonel John trying to go with him. Raven's Pass. But now it's Curlin made this huge run. Can he go on? Whip comes out on him. Raven's Pass down the center. Henry the Navigator's running on. Colonel John on the inside. Curlin now in deep water. He has to dig deep, but it's going to be Raven's Pass to take him on. Along the inside, Henry the Navigator's coming home gamely as well. But it's going to be Raven's Pass to win it. Raven's Pass, and Frankie Dettori have won the Classic.
Well, a look back at last year's Breeders' Cup Classic. And Frank, as we pointed out earlier, a couple of European horses invading and getting a large portion of the money.
And they did a very nice job, and they came out of the QE2 last year, and they'll try to do it again this year. And it's Rip Van Winkle who is going to try to come right in to the Breeders' Cup Classic, a son of Galileo, three-year-old, 4-for-8 lifetime with earnings of just under $1 million.
How about Aidan O'Brien with a double-barreled classic group here between Rip Van Winkle and Master Craftsman? And Frank Lyons told us yesterday that Aidan O'Brien said to him that Rip Van Winkle might be the best horse he ever trained.
You have to trust the voice of one of the all-time legendary trainers.
Let's take a look at Rip Van Winkle as we just took a look at the division leaders for the Breeders' Cup Classic, and we are going to the Queen Elizabeth II Stakes on September 26th from Ascot. And this was his first start back off a layoff.
Rip Van Winkle, Zakinto beginning a charge down the outside. Rip Van Winkle leading from Delegator, who leans into Zakinto as they both try and hunt down Rip Van Winkle, who goes inside the last. Zakinto got to within about half a length and running a mighty race on the outside. Still Rip Van Winkle. Zakinto has got to win half a length, but now the stamina comes into play and Rip Van Winkle will win the QE2.
Rip Van Winkle, a game and determined effort off the layoff, and Zakinto, another very talented Breeders' Cup contender coming over this year.
It was a lightly raced Judmont horse, Zakinto. And Rip Van Winkle, it wasn't a flashy performance, but it was one where he proved he was best. And it was, you know, he did what he needed to do. He won by a length and a quarter. They were well clear of Delegator, who finished a distant third. And Rip Van Winkle coming into this race, trying to do what has happened before, and it happened just last year.
And Einstein, right at the top of that list, won the Santa Anita Handicap over the Pro Ride Surface. So it should be very, very interesting, and I think you're going to get a price on him. European success in the Breeders' Cup Classic, the foreign flavor. Well, as we said, Raven's Pass winning it last year. And look at these performances here by Saki, Giant's Causeway, Arkong, of course, at the huge price, 133-1.
And those are two photo losses to Tiz Now with Giant's Causeway and Saki, or the numbers would be even that stronger, that much stronger. So obviously, the foreign flavor, as we list here, is one that's going to be strong yet again.
And again, a look at U.S. versus the world on the left side. Einstein, Gio Ponti, Mind That Bird, Summer Bird, and Zenyatta. And the situation with Gio Ponti, well, Christophe Clément says, what else does he have to prove on the turf? Where am I going to go with this horse in the Breeders' Cup? Let's try the Breeders' Cup Classic, because that would be something different. So do the Mosses and John Sheriffs and Mike Smith kind of make that same assessment? I mean, she's done everything. She's undefeated. She's beaten every distaffer that she has faced in her career. And that's a lot of horses, Frank. Do they say, do we do something different now? Do we really do something that will set her apart? Do we go after the Breeders' Cup Classic? What is your thought on that?
I really believe it's a decision that they have to make, and either decision, I think, is fine. And I think Steve Crist really wrapped it up very well in his article. He actually stated, why do it now? Because Horse of the Year really isn't an option because of the fact that, in his opinion, Rachel Alexandra has already accomplished that mission, which is to get Horse of the Year, regardless of what happens in the Breeders' Cup. And I don't think the Mosses are going to make this decision based on anything other than what they feel is the best possible thing for Zenyatta. And Zenyatta, she'd be about 1-5 or 2-5 against Music Note and the distaffers in that race. She'd be, you know, one of the contenders on the odds board in the Breeders' Cup Classic. I really don't have a strong opinion one way or another as to what she should do. I think that's a decision for the Mosses, John Sheriffs, to make that decision together. And whatever it is, I think that we, as the racing fans of the world, need to just admire her and respect that decision for whatever it may be.
All right, and I read a post here as recently as 5:31 p.m. Pacific time today from Inglewood, California. Although no decision has been made on which race Zenyatta will compete in this year's Breeders' Cup at Santa Anita's Oak Tree Meeting, she was put through a strong workout on Friday morning at Hollywood Park. The trainer, John Sheriff, said, and I quote, leaves open the option for the Classic. And this about an hour old.
That's great news. As a racing fan, don't get me wrong, I certainly hope that Zenyatta goes and takes on the boys in the Breeders' Cup Classic. And I hope that she eventually meets Rachel Alexandra to settle that issue once and for all at a neutral track somewhere in the United States. But as a fan, we also have to just respect the connections. And the Mosses have been so great to the game. In fact, even having her in her five-year-old campaign, that by itself is definitely against the norm, Gary.
All right, a couple shows coming up as we run out of time on this edition of Countdown to the Cup. We've got a whole show on U.S. versus the world. Why? Because when you're talking about the Breeders' Cup, you have to talk about the U.S., where the races are held, the home country, the home field advantage, if you will, and the world. And the world has come to the Breeders' Cup over all these years, Frank, and has done very, very well on our home turf, if you will.
They do, typically on the turf races, certainly, and in some of the other races that has been happening as well. And some of the best racing in the world does come overseas.
All right, so catch that at 7 a.m. That's Pacific time.
And this is an important show because of the fact that we want to see how they're acclimating, Gary, to their new environment before the big dance.
Absolutely. Wherever they're coming from, horses coming from back east, don't forget, a little bit different. I mean, it's getting chilly. We saw Simon Bray in Chicago. He was mighty cold. These horses are now coming to Southern California, where traditionally, at that time of the year, at a place like Santa Anita out in Arcadia, California, it can be very, very hot.
And we've got Simon Bray and Tom Amos, two outstanding horsemen, to give you their assessment of the actual horses in action, and that's very important.
All right, that'll do it for Countdown to the Cup. For Frank Miramani, I'm Gary Seibel. After the break, we've got more live racing, and don't forget, we've also got a little talk about harness. I'm going to stick around for that.